We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome to First Baptist Church online worship service. We pray that this service blesses you, and we thank you for joining us today. Remember today and every day that the Lord is worthy of all our praise.
Hello, everyone. Hi, this is Jerome and Esther Whitehurst. We're just here to give our church testimonial, and I'd like my wife to share with some memories of our first meeting.
So in 1989, when we moved to Antioch, we were looking for a church home. And one of the churches we decided to visit was First Baptist Church. Our first visit, we really enjoyed and really felt the spirit that was here in the church. It reminded us of our church home where we moved from in San Jose.
One of the things that First Baptist also offered us was some great ministries that was very close to our upbringing, and ministry that we were close to, our women's ministry and the men's ministry, Sunday school. So we were just ecstatic.
To seek the Lord even more so in our lives. So the thing we love best about First Baptist is it truly is a family. Where the Spirit dwells, Pastor Perkins is such a dynamic pastor, and we have such a wonderful First Lady, and everyone here truly is family. So we're grateful and we're thankful to be members of First Baptist Church.
Worthy God, hallelujah.
Yes.
Psalm 27 says, hallelujah. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? We've come to declare this morning that we have no fear, because God is our light. He dispels the darkness. God is our strength. He's our stronghold. He's our anchor. Hallelujah. That's why we don't have to worry. We don't have to be afraid. So stand on your feet with us and clap those hands. We come to declare that we have no fear. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now tell me, who has the final say?
Jehovah has the final say.
Tell me, who has the final say? And no matter what the doctor says,
Jehovah has the final say.
And no matter what your bills may say,
Jehovah has the final say.
See,
I have no reason to fear.
See,
I have no reason to
the
fear. I have no reason to fear.
Say, I have no reason.
I have no reason to fear.
Say, I have today. Hallelujah. We are assured of the fact. Hallelujah. Yes, God, that He is our light and our salvation. We have nothing to fear because He is our strength, our stronghold, our anchor, our fortress. Hallelujah. You are my strength. Just declare that to yourself today. That's why I don't have to fear. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You are our strength, oh God. Strength like no other. Hallelujah. Strength like no other. Come on, lift your voice and sing with us. You are.
You are my strength.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Hallelujah, reaches.
Reaches to me.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
And
Somebody bless the Lord today, for he is worthy to be praised. He is a magnificent God, a God so magnificent that he did what no other could do. He gave his only begotten son, Jesus, that we might be free. This morning, we want to just welcome you and thank you for being with us today. But a God we serve is wonderful. He's awesome. And if you look back over your life, you can close your eyes and you yourself can see how good God has been. So as we move and function in this day and time, we're praying that each man, woman, and child just reflect on the goodness of the Lord. I know your eyes and your mind are showing you different things, confusion and sickness. But the God we serve is able to comfort you and heal, give you peace and joy, even in the midst of a time like this. So we're going to pray this morning that our Lord and Savior just continue to fan the fire that's in each and every one of us, reviving us so that we can continue the work that we've been called to do. Even outside of the walls of our church, where we can be more effective by spreading the gospel to a dying world. Let us pray. Father God, we say thank you. We thank you, Lord, for a love like no other. We glorify you, Lord, because if it had not been for you, where would we be? We lift you up today, Lord God. Even in the midst of all that we're seeing going on, there are some doubting, Lord, but we lift you up. Because if it had not been for you, where would we be? Because you called us out of a dark world. Because you picked us up out of dirt and mud. Because you turned us around from the road we were walking on. Gave us a new life. Gave us a new way of thinking. Gave us a new way of talking. Gave us a new way of living. So we say thank you, Lord. We glorify you, Lord God. We pray this morning, Lord, that you fan the fire. Remind us of all that you've done for us. Allow your light to shine so bright through each and every one of us that those around us are just in awe at how we could be at peace. How could we have such joy in the midst of this time? We say thank you, Lord. We glorify you today, Father God. We magnify your name, Father God. If we look around and we can see your miracles left and right, Father God, we see your healing power, Lord God. We see you making ways even in the midst of high unemployment. We see you sustaining families even in the midst of low finances. We glorify you, Lord, because even in the midst of a time like this, you're present, Lord God, and we say thank you. So as we just think and reflect on all that you've done for us, we just move our hands, move our feet, fanning the fire of memory of all that you've done, and we say thank you, Lord. We glorify you. We magnify your name, and we'll keep still showing this world around us that's concerned with the things of this world, how good God really is. glorify you today, Lord God. We magnify you today, Lord God. And we say thank you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for sending your only begotten Son. Thank you for taking our stripes. Thank you for walking down in humiliation. Thank you for taking the nails in his hands and the nails in his feet. Thank you for hanging on that cross just for us. Thank you, Lord, for taking our sins to the grave. But oh, hallelujah, I'm here today because 3 days later, he got up with all power in his hands. So we glorify you today for Jesus, our waymaker, Jesus, our knight in shining armor, Jesus, our doors in troubled times, Jesus, the one that can calm the seas, heal the lame, raise the dead, Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. We magnify you today, Lord. And we say thank you, Jesus, for all that you've done for us. God bless you. Amen.
Come on, wherever you are, just put your hands together. Help me lift up this song. Oh, you don't have to praise with me. I know what he's done for me. Bless the Lord at all times. Hallelujah. Happy to know it's at the mention of Jesus' name. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall proclaim that he's the Lord, risen Savior. Amen. So this song simply says, at the mention of your name, God, that every knee shall bow and every tongue proclaim. And we will profess that you are Lord. Amen.
Jesus, at the mention of your name, every knee shall bow and tongue proclaim, Jesus. Of your name, every knee shall bow and tongue proclaim, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, you are saved.
Peace.
bow and tongue proclaim, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, you are Savior, you are Lord, and you are God. Oh, hallelujah.
Give God thanks and praise for who He is. Him being God, a sovereign God, that everything he does well. We thank him that at the mention of his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Thank him for his son, who is our Savior, who died on the cross that we may have life and have life more abundantly, into the Spirit, the Holy Spirit that sustains us from day to day. We are grateful to God for who He is in our lives today. Very pleasant good morning to all of you, and we greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, to the angel, prophet, priest of this house, none other than Dr. Henry L. Perkins. We give God praise for him. That's right. Wherever you are, we thank him for the leader that he is. Thank him for just the husband that he is and grandfather. He's just a good Perkins. Amen. And I bless the Lord for him, how he's poured into my ministry over the past 26 years. And I give thanks and praise to God that he continues to invest in me, the gift that God has placed on my life. And I want to tell him thank you for this privilege and this opportunity, and just for being uncle that you are. Then he wouldn't be who he is if it wasn't for who she is, Lady Perkins. Amen. We give thanks for Lady Perkins on this morning. Amen. For who she is, standing by her man in ministry. What a blessing it is to have co-laborers in ministry. And to you, the First Baptist Church, it is a joy to be here to share with you again one more time. And under these circumstances, just to be alive is always a good day. Amen. And we bless the Lord. I want to thank God again for this privilege and share today what the Lord has placed on my heart for such a time as this last Sunday of October, as we give God thanks that he has blessed us, if you will, to see another Sunday. Let's pray together. Consecrate me, Lord, to thy service by the power of love divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, Lord, to the cross where you have died. Draw me nearer to thy precious bleeding side. Lord, I ask on this day that you would anoint us afresh and breathe on us again. Allow your word go forth in spite of our faults, failures, and fatigue, so that when we leave from this place and this worship experience, rather virtual or wherever we may be, that we are better Christians, so we can be a better church. We give you thanks and praise now. In the name of the strong name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I want to call your attention this morning to this passage of scripture. Should not be hard to find in the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 8 is where I want to look this morning. Genesis chapter 8, and I want to look at a few verses, Genesis chapter 8, and look at a few verses beginning from, if you will, verse number 1. Genesis chapter 8, beginning verse number 1, and this is how it reads. And God remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. And God made a wind pass over the earth and the waters swage. The fountains also of the deep, the windows of heaven were stopped. The rain from heaven was restrained. And the waters returned from off the earth continually. And after the end of the 150 days, the waters were abated. And the ark rested in the seventh month on the seventh day of the month upon the mountains of Arid. And I want to skip down to verse 15, where it says, and God spake to Noah, saying, verse 16, go forth of the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. I want to stop there, and I'll read verse 20. And Noah built an altar unto the Lord and took every clean beast and every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. 21, and the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. The imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite anymore everything living as I have done. I want to put a tag on the text and speak from this topic. I want to talk about God will remember you while in your shelter in place. That's what I want to talk about. God will remember you while you're in your shelter in place. The grass wither, the flower fade, the word of our Lord shall stand forever. The word of God is for the people of God, and his word is already blessed. Thanks be unto God. God will remember you while in your shelter in place. If I'm not mistaken, we are on week 31. We're beginning week 31. Since the last time we were able to come together to August body and be in worship under the same roof. March 15th, to be exact, that third Sunday of March was the last time that we were able to come together. And when we left church, we had no idea that that would be the last time we would meet. We were already planning, if you will, to come back to church for Sunday, do our regular ritual of what we do. And then on March 17th, the world shut down. I mean, literally, they told us, don't go outside. And as I open this message on this morning, I will say this before I shout too quick. In spite of 31 weeks, I've come to tell you God has shown himself to be still be good. That in the midst of all this chaos that has been going on, I can honestly say that God has revealed himself to be a God that, if you will, has caused my faith to be stronger now than it was in March. Is there a witness in virtual land that will testify that you don't have the faith you used to have when you started in 2020 because of this doggone pandemic that we've been going through? And thanks be to God, you're stronger now. You're wiser now. Lord have mercy, you're better. But here it is. I said verse 1, if you will, of chapter 8. It starts off really good, I think, for anybody. And when we think about it, it says, and God remembered Noah. What a great person to remember you, if you will. Because, listen, let's be honest. Nobody likes to be forgotten. And if we're honest with ourselves, we remember the things we should forget. And we forget the things that we should remember. And when we talk about Noah, when we hear of Noah, we got to give Noah his props because Noah does something that none of us have been able to do yet. He may have been a drunkard, but he saved his whole family. Let's just be real. Some of us got some folk in our family now. I'll keep on pushing on that needs to know who the Lord is. But listen, Noah is that man, if you will, that is considered a man not only that builds in the midst of opposition and others' opinion, and even in the midst of obstacles, but he builds at a time where there's no clouds in the sky. Are you with me? The Lord, if you will, starts speaking to him in chapter 6 of Genesis to build this ark. He builds the ark, and then he boards the ark. And after he boards the ark, the Bible says that Noah was blameless. But not only that, but Noah believed God when it didn't look like his word was worth taking. Are you still with me? And listen, you can say whatever you want to say about Noah, but the good news is when you go to Hebrews chapter 11, Noah is in the hall of faith. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? Which means that he trusted God even when he did not understand God and did not see rain anywhere. I wonder who I'm talking to now that says, you said you loved Jesus in March, but then the Lord said, let me send something your way to see how much you really trust him. Here it is, a faith that cannot be tested cannot be trusted. I'll slow down, rewind, and say it again. A faith that cannot be trust tested cannot be trust, if you will. God has to send us through situations to test our faith, and this is what he does with Noah. In Noah, in this scripture, if you will, I want you to know that the earth has been flooded for 313 days. Are you with me? Noah literally is inside of the ark for 370 days. Are you with me? Noah is on a wooden boat with his family and animals for over a year. And some of us were ready to be out of shelter in place after a week. Are you listening to me? But here it is. He's in this shelter in place. Matter of fact, I would argue, Uncle, that this is the first shelter in place that ever happened because of how God described and works with Noah while on this shelter in place cruise liner. Are y'all with me? And so the text says, if you will, first I see within chapter 8 that there is the promise of preservation, where God promises to keep Noah even in the midst of a flood and water. Not only is there the promise of preservation, but then there is present provision, which means that whatever God creates, he not only has to preserve, but he has to give provision for. And that's why we thank him, because even in the midst of a pandemic, this didn't catch God by surprise, and neither has God been in heaven scratching his head wondering how he's going to provide for us. God has just been doing what he's been doing over the years, and the same God that has been keeping us in the past, come on church, is the same God that's keeping us right now. Not only is he a present in provision, but he teaches us that we have to have patience doing this process. Yes, what we're going through right now, if you will, it is a process, because if we're honest with ourselves, before we can try to take something out of someone else's eye, this has been a great litmus test for ourselves to see what we need to get right in our own lives. We should be able to say that since March 15th, we have a stronger prayer life. We have a closer walk with the Lord, because instead of us going, if you will, to Sunday school, the school came to the house. Are y'all listening to me? We having church at home now, and everybody is on the sick and shut-in list. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? But look at what the text says. The text says in verse 1, God remembered Noah. It does not mean, and before I rush too soon, it does not mean, family and friends, if you will, that God forgets, because we know within his attributes, he is a God that is all-knowing. But when he says that God remembered, it suggests to us that God remembers some specific specific things. What are the specific things? God remembers his creation. God, if you will, not only remembers his creation, but God remembers his covenant. The covenant that he's made with us, he remembers it. And then not only that, but God remembers his champion, Noah, because Noah does something that nobody else in history has ever done. But then I want us to understand that if God remembers his covenant, that God also remembers our crisis. That whatever we're going through, God knows what we're dealing with, and he knows how much. Come on, how much we can bear. So here it is. This is what I see in this text. I see that Noah teaches us, one, that we have to do some tarrying. We have to do some waiting on the Lord. That there are times in our life within this Christian walk that things don't go like we want them to go, but God teaches us, if you will, how to wait on him. We have to do some tarrying, but then when we're going through our time of tarrying, waiting on him, he takes us through time of testing. And you do know that whenever the teacher would give a test, sometimes the teacher would still be in the room, but they wouldn't do no talking. Are y'all listening to me? It says to us that when God is silent, it doesn't mean that he's not still there. He's just trying to make sure he has our undivided attention. Then after testing, there comes the time of trusting. And from trusting, we get to the point where we're able to be thankful. And then from thankfulness, we get to where we are able to give our testimony. Let me share the few points I have. The first thing that I see in this text is Noah's security, where he has reassurance working for God. You have to know, family and friends, that whenever you do something for the Lord and that he's commanded you to do it, that you have assurance that God will have your back. That God will not only have your back, but God will be with you. According to the text says, as I said, he remembered. But if you keep reading in verse 1, it suggests not only that he remembered, but it suggests, if you will, that the waters were made to do something because the wind passed by. And I would have you to know that whenever wind blows, you do know that wind rearranges. Are you with me? And this same word wind is the word that is used for Roha, Numa, that is used in Genesis 1 when he blows upon us, if you will, and puts a life into a living soul. And isn't it amazing to know that even as we're going through this pandemic, I don't know what your prayer is, but my prayer has been, Lord, keep breathing on me. If I'm going to make it from week to week, I need you to breathe on me. If I'm going to be able to handle what's going on in our city, in our country, and in our state, I need you to keep putting a fresh wind on me. But here's the other thing that I found, Uncle Perkins, and that is that whenever wind blows, whatever ain't planted to the ground got to go. And I've come to let some people know, you ought to thank God for this pandemic. Because if the pandemic hadn't come, the wind hadn't blown, you'll still be holding on to some stuff that you thought you needed. Okay, y'all go play. You'll still be holding on to some people that you thought you needed. But because the wind blew, it lets you know who's really rolling with you and who's not rolling with you. The text suggests to us, if you will, that the wind blew. And after the wind blew, the waters began, if you will, to recede, that the waters began to recede. The Bible says that God restrained the waters because water was coming from the heavens and water was coming from below. Are you still with me? And listen, if it's one thing for water to come from the heavens, but it's another thing that while water is coming from the heavens, for water to be coming from below. Has anybody ever felt like that before? you can get through dealing with one problem. Come on, it's another problem. Somebody said it, don't be too holy, don't look at me funny, but somebody wrote a song and said, if it ain't one thing, y'all go play today. It's another, that before I can get through dealing with one problem, here comes another. But here's the good news, that the God that we serve can tell all of our problems, that's enough, take a chill pill. And that's what God says. He says, I need to restrain the water because it's enough water. And now the true test is getting ready to come. And look at what the text says. The text says that he restrains the water and the water begins to recede. And here it is in verse number 4 is where I almost lost my mind, literally. Verse number 4, because verse number 4 says, listen, that when the waters receded, that the boat, the ship, the ark, the box, whatever you want to call it, it lands on Mount Ararat. It lands, listen, on top of a mountain. Matter of fact, according to verse 4, it had plural. It said mountains of Ararat, which suggests to me, if you will, that watch this, that when the storm ends, that they're not in the same place that they started. Y'all don't hear a word I'm saying, because the text would suggest to us that when God told Noah to build the ark, that there wasn't no water nowhere, which meant that they were on a certain level, meant they were level to the ground. But when the storm came and the storm was over, they were on higher. I wish y'all would help me. What are you saying, Perk? I'm simply saying that these storms that we're going through, this pandemic that we're going through, you should not be on the same level when we come out of this. You ought to be on a high level. You ought to be praying better. You ought to be praying stronger. You ought to have a better walk with the Lord, a better talk with the Lord, because you know you're on a higher level. Let's be, is there anybody that can testify that your faith is stronger since March 15th? Because when the waters receded, they were on a different level, which meant that it wasn't all a bad thing going through this flood. And if you're careful, you'll hear people talk and say, I'm so tired of this pandemic, and it's been bitter for me, and it hasn't been a blessing. Well, every morning you wake up and you ever to see yourself in the mirror and put your own clothes on, I would argue that it's a blessing in the midst of a pandemic, that God is still keeping you. Watch how the text moves, if you will. It says that after the boat had rested, point one, Noah's security, his reassurance working for God. His point two, Noah's search, he recognizes that he has to wait on God. And let's just be honest. We've had found ourselves in some waiting situations. Yeah, since this pandemic has hit, since we've been on this quarantine, if you will, we've had to wait on God to continue to show himself mighty and show himself strong. If you look, if you will, that before Noah can make any move, he has to make sure that he gets permission to make his move. Because watch, in Genesis 7, 15, if you will, God shuts the door. And he shuts the door in Genesis 7, 15. And here it is. He does not say anything to Noah for over a year. And here's my challenge to you, and I'm almost halfway done. How do you respond when God is silent? What do I do when he's not responding to me? And let's be honest, some have prayed and feel like God went on vacation and didn't leave a forwarding address, and wondering, is he ever going to respond? I would argue that when God is silent, That means you just got to wait on him. That's all it means. When God does not respond to you, it doesn't mean that you begin more fear than faith. You have to then hold on to hold on to scripture and hold on to hymns of the church, if you will, and hold on to your experience to know that God is true to his word. And whatever he has me waiting on, it will be worth the wait because I'll be better when he shows up. Yeah, he says, so Noah says, okay, I can't do anything until I get permission to do it. And he's waiting on God. God has been silent. And so Noah is getting cabin fever. And so he released, according to the text, he released a raven. Now, the raven that he released, if you will, a raven is a scavenger. A raven, if you will, when he gets to flying, he's always going to do what his first nature is, and that is try to find stuff for himself. Lord have mercy. He's not concerned about others. He's always concerned about himself, if you will. And this raven, Noah releases him, and the raven does not return. The question is, why does he not return? Because if his nature is to be about himself, and if his nature is to eat carcasses and eat, if you will, dead things, imagine it's been a flood. Come on. There are many things that are dead make it. So that means he has a plethora to eat, but he forgets about where he came from. I'm trying to help the church right here, because you have to be careful about people that they're with you, if you will, when you can help them. But then when they get on their feet and it's time for you to need help, they're nowhere to be found. Are y'all listening to me? You got to watch out for them raven mentality people, because they're always concerned about themselves but not concerned about helping others. The text also, if you will, goes on to share with us on tonight that after he releases this raven, he decides, if you will, to allow a dove to be released. And this is what I want you to get on tonight. And don't forget this part of the message, and I'll be done. That Noah is ready to get off of this ark. He's been on it for over a year. And here it is now. He released the raven. It doesn't return. Do you realize that Noah is on an ark with his family for over a year? Not only is Noah on the ark with his family for over a year, but Noah is also on the ark with some animals for over a year. Now, some of y'all gonna act brand new, if you will, won't tell the truth, but some of y'all can't hang around your family for 2 days. Come on, let's be real. You got a time limit, because you know if I keep hanging around, if we keep hanging around, some go jump out. We don't need no strangers, because that's just how our family, y'all gonna talk back to me. That's just the truth. But here it is. It's one thing to be trapped on the ark with my family, but Green, I'm on the ark with some animals, and here it is, Trent. There's no Roto-Rooter. I wish y'all heard me. There's no plumbing system, Pastor Perkins. And we on the ark for over a year. Can I just suggest this to the church? Because Auntie, this is what bothers me. Folks talk about the church is all this, and I'm not going to church no more, and they doing this down the church. But when stuff happen at your job, you still go the next day to get paid. But as soon as something happened in church, I knew I shouldn't have went down there. I shouldn't have been bothered with them people. But let something happen in your organization, you still going back the next week. Can I just help the church right here? Please know, and I just need to say this because it's on my heart. Please know that if you're in the church, church is messy. How do you know? Because here it is. They are on the ark. They're with their family. They're with animals. But it's messy on the inside. But how many know that whenever you are really doing ministry, somebody is always working for the messy committee? Somebody's always, if you will, representing the messy committee. But how many can say, in spite of the mess on the ark, I thank God for his mercy, because his mercy suits my case. I would rather be safe on the ark than to be in a messy ark, than to be on the clean boat full of hypocrites. I wish y'all heard me. Because ministry is messy. And if there's no evidence of mess, it may mean ain't no ministry going on. I'm trying to help somebody. Stop getting upset when messy folk come around. Can I just say this and still be loved? The church was perfect till you showed up. Yeah, it was good till we got there. It was a great church. And all I'm trying to say, we all have our mess that we're dealing with, and we don't have time, if you will, to be giving each other bad time, because we're all operating under the mercy of God. And Noah teaches us that even though it's messy, you still can be saved. That's what he teaches us, because he says when he sends this dove out, dove comes back, if you will. Can you give me a little bit more volume, please, to the monitors? The dove comes back, if you will, and he comes back with an olive leaf in his hand, in his mouth, rather. And the olive leaf represents, here it is, that in spite of the waters being high, in spite of the waters being low, that olives, if you do any type of research, olives leaves are able to withstand any type of storm. They're able to survive. And that's what I want to thank God for, because even in the midst of this pandemic, we can bless the Lord on today that at the end of the day, we can say that we're survivors, that we have been surviving week after week, and we're trusting when it's time, if you will, to come back, that God will give us the, okay, here's the next point, then I'm done. Noah gives his surveillance. He removes the roof in your spare time. If you go and you read through, if you will, Genesis, you'll notice that it was only one door, but then there was like a sunroof that was made that he was able to look out and see. And here it is, the text will suggest to us that yes, Noah was waiting on God, but now he has to continue to walk with God. When times get rough, you have to continue to walk with God. You have to have a mindset to say that this is just temporary. And friends, let me tell you this, don't get used to all this virtual stuff. Don't get too comfortable having church in your pajamas, eating your Wheaties. That's not, Lord have mercy, that's not the purpose of why God created the church. And the reason I know that I'm right, because he wouldn't have never wrote Hebrews 10:25, forsake not the fellowship, which meant that it's something about the people of God coming together. And don't let society, don't let the world make you think it's normal for you to do everything off your phone and never leave your house. No, that's not the intention. No, that's not the intention. It's this what we're going through is just temporary. Yes, it is. It cannot be permanent, because God says that when we come together, something happens. He inhabits the praise of his people. Something happens when the people of God comes together. And I don't know when we go come back, but I'm anticipating the day that we do. And I already know what I'm going to preach, Uncle Perk, that Sunday if I get to preach. I'm preaching that number from Psalms. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go back into the house of the Lord, because I'm anticipating that day to come, because I believe it's going to come. But in the meantime, let the church say, in the meantime, we cannot be in a rush to get back, because it ain't safe yet. Now, here's my solution. I can't tell you what to do, but I have a few buddies that passed across the country. One of them I talk to regularly, Pastor Marvin Wiley, and he say, Perk, whenever the White House opened, That's when I'm going to go back to church. Whenever they start doing tours for the Smithsonian and all those good buildings, that's when I'm going back to church, because it suggests that if stuff is not happening high in government, it should be happening down low. Are y'all listening? It means, here it is, that listen, while what we're going through, if you will, is temporarily, but here it is, we don't have to be in a rush to get back, because lives are at stake. And one life is too much to lose to be in a rush to come back. Do you hear what I'm saying? And here it is, and I'm done. I bid us a good day. The text says that in verse 15, if I'm not mistaken, of chapter 8, that God speaks to Noah after being silent for a year, because the person that shuts you in is the only person that has the power to tell you to come out. Are y'all listening to me? And here it is in a nutshell. We cannot move on what our president says do. Can't move on even what the governor feels is right to do. God, when he speaks to the leader of the First Baptist Church, he gonna speak to one man. I wish I had a witness in the building. And that's the under shepherd that God has placed for the First Baptist Church. Notice that the Bible says that God spoke to Noah, not his kids. God spoke to Noah, not his wife. God spoke to Noah, not his grandkids. And all I'm saying is that when God feels that it's time and it's safe for First Baptist to come back and unite, guess who he'll speak to? He'll talk to the leader. He'll talk to the under shepherd. He'll talk to the one that is steward over his people. And listen, family and friends, don't get caught in what everybody else is doing. Do what God is doing and follow your leader as he follows Christ. I'm done. Here it is. The text says, in a nutshell, he says, Noah gives a sacrifice. Noah says, listen, not only have I been walking with God and working with God, and have I been waiting on God? But Noah says, now I'm going to worship God. He's given me the opportunity to get off this ark, get off this ship. And according to the text, Noah does something immediately. According to verse 20, says that Noah built an altar. Noah says, I'm going to make sure that if I don't make it to church, here it is, I still have church. And that's what I want to keep telling our family, brothers and sisters, that whatever you do, keep worshiping God. No matter where you are, this building, if you will, we may not be under the same building, but we're still under the same banner. One Lord, one faith, and one baptism. And so Noah, if you will, challenges us to be responsible, that when God has brought you through, the first thing you ought to do is have some church. When God brings you through another month, don't wait till you come to church. Don't wait till the virtual service comes on. Just have church wherever you at. Tell him thank you that he's brought you through another day. Because truth be told, you don't know if you'll see tomorrow. You don't know if you'll see the next day. And so, family and friends, here's the good news. The text says that he worships God, and it is a sweet savor unto him. Your worship means something to God. And notice, if you will, text didn't say that he clapped his hands. It said that he opened his mouth, and he gave thanks to God for seeing them through a flood. I wonder, is there anybody in the building, anybody in virtual land, I'm done, that can say, Lord, thank you that you kept me some 31 weeks. Literally, things could have went another way. Thank you, Lord, that every COVID test I took kept coming up negative. I wish that's the first time I say negative. Thank you. We all should be able to give God thanks and worship in our own way. Is there anybody in the building that can testify that when you think about the goodness of, I know it's a cliche, but it's so good right here, that when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me. My soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. And that's what our prayer should be, that God has saved us. If you ask Noah, Noah will say that I shout today because God has kept me. And if you know that God has kept you, you can have church all by yourself. That even though you may not have your prayer partner by you, you still can lift your hands and give God praise. Even in your shelter in place, you got to admit that God still has been an on-time God. That even though you may not have gotten a stimulus check, you still didn't miss no meals. Have I got a witness in the building? Is there anybody that can testify that you know God is still keeping you? Don't touch nobody, but look at somebody and say, I may not know, a lot of things, but one thing I know, God, he is a keeper, and he's still keeping me. Well, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. But I just begin to think, Perkins, how would they have church if they just got off of the ark? And I want to ask somebody, how are you going to act when you get the text message, when you get the letter in the mail, when you get the Facebook notification that we're on our way back to church? Cannot speak for you, but I'm going to do what David said. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Is there anybody in the building, anybody in virtual land that can lift your hand and tell God thank you that he let you make it through one more week? Is there anybody that can say God has been good to me? God has set us free. And I want you to know, as I go to my seat, if you were to interview somebody and ask them, how did you make it off the ark? They would simply say, we made it because God remembered us. Yes. Is that anybody's testimony? I'm standing here because God remembered me. He was true to his word. Though you may feel like you're by yourself, he said, I'll be with you even until the end of the day. How many can testify that God is still with us? How many can testify that we've had some crying days, but we're encouraged by the word that said, weeping may, weeping may endure for a night, but joy, joy will come in the morning. Y'all got to excuse me now. My soul done got happy, because I've been thinking about how long I've been sheltering in my place. But I decided to change my S, not from sheltering, but now to studying in place. And not from studying, but now to shouting in place. Is there anybody in the building, anybody in virtual land that can thank God that you can shout in place, you can study in place, you can be sacred in place. Yes, I'm going to my seat when I tell you the storm came, the wind blew, the water came, but everybody was saved. If you ask somebody, how did you get saved? They'll tell you that ark saved my life. That messy ark gave me another chance. That messy ark purchased my salvation. And Trent, the more I looked at the boat, the more I started scratching my head, because I started thinking about they were saved by a wooden ark. But I started rejoicing because I was saved by some wood too. I wish I had somebody on a hill far away, stood an old rugged cross. How many can thank God that he saved us by two pieces of wood? If you know you're saved, can you lift your hand and tell God, thank you for saving me. Thank you that I'm saved by the wood. And how many know the second shelter in place was not them on the boat, but when he died, when he died, that was a shelter in place. But early, I said early, Sunday morning, he came out that shelter in place with all power in his hand. Lord have mercy. I've been through the fire. I've been through the flood. I've been in the broken pieces. Seen lightning flash above. But through it all, I remember how he loves me and he cares. And he'll never put more on us than we can bear. Shout yeah! Shout yeah! Shout yeah! Shout yeah! Shout yeah! Yeah! Hey! Hallelujah! He won't put more on us than we can bear. God will remember you even in your shelter in place. You know, the unfortunate thing, some people have been in the house since March and they've been forgotten about. Nobody's called. Nobody checked on them. But family and friends, I have you to know, God will remember you. Don't be discouraged. Don't be dismayed. God will take care of you. That's what the old hymn said. God will take care of you. And he's able to take care of you because he's not going to forget about you. When you get a chance, go back to Genesis 8 and read it. And where it says Noah, put your name. And God remembered Anthony. Yeah. Put your name there and make it personal to know that whatever comes down the road, Lord have mercy. God is not going to forget about you. Even in the midst of this shelter in place. Don't care what happens on November 3rd. We know we need to vote. Please vote. Please vote. Yeah, vote. But God still got everything in control. He's not on no tenure. He ain't got to be voted in or voted out. He still knows what we need. I don't know who I'm talking to. We're getting ready to enter to November. That season of, it's a hard season for some people. That stretch between November and the first of the year. It's a hard stretch for some people. And I want you to know that this word is portable. For you to take it wherever you go, to know that God won't forget about you. He will remember you. Maybe you're virtual land and you never made a commitment to the Lord. He says, I won't forget about you, but I do want relationship with you. See, when you in a relationship with somebody, it's hard to forget about them. Yeah. He says, I don't want you to serve me through religion. I want you to have a relationship. See, Noah had a bona fide relationship because he trusted God even when he didn't understand. Even when he was fearful and afraid, he still trusts God. Maybe you need to trust him with your life today. If that's you, just put in the comments, I want a relationship. And I'm sure someone from the First Baptist staff will contact you and rejoice with you at a time to come into the ark of safety. That's what the old church would say. To the ark of safety. Get on the old ship of Zion. Had landed many of thousands. King Jesus is the captain. You ought to give your life to the Lord. Because listen, you can't make it through this without God. And then maybe you're looking for a church home. First Baptist is a great church to be a part of. Bible teaching, Bible believing. Great, solid ministry. Every age of the family. You ought to bring your whole family and become a part of this wonderful church. And if that's you, just say, I want to unite. You join clubs, but we unite with the church. And we'll be happy to have you. Happy to have you. And someone from the staff will contact you. I want you to be encouraged to know that God will take care of you in spite of. He'll be there for you, and you don't have to worry about anything because he'll never put more on us than we could bear. Father, we thank you for the power of your word. Thank you, Lord, that even in our shelter in place, you never forget about us. Thank you, oh God, that you continue to not only remember us, but to preserve, protect, and provide for us. And even when times get rough, we know we can hold on to you. We give you thanks and praise for the power of your word. Thank you for another chance. It's in the strong name of Jesus we pray. Pray that, Lord, you would touch those that need to make a decision. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for attending First Baptist Church of Pittsburgh online worship service. We do trust God that you were truly blessed by the preached word.
If you have been led to contribute to the First Baptist Church ministry, there are multiple ways to do so. By phone, you can text the dollar amount and fund name to area code 925-232-4426. You can also visit our website at www.fbpittsburgh.org and click the Give Online button to submit your secure donation. Or you can give using our mobile app. You can download the app by visiting the Apple or Google Play Store and search FBC Pittsburgh. Once you have downloaded the app, click on the Give Online option to process your secure donation. We thank you in advance and may God bless you richly.
Follow First Baptist on social media, on our various platforms, Facebook and Instagram. Subscribe to YouTube and visit our website, www.fbpittsburgh.org. You may also download our mobile app from the Apple Store or Google Play. We ask that you like and share our video with your family and friends today. We pray that you stay safe and healthy, and continued blessings.